Good evening. My name is Okwui Enwezor. I'm the director of House of Kunst. And gives me great pleasure to welcome all of you here this evening. I was hoping that the weather would be more agreeable, but we've really enjoyed a great week of sunshine. So it stands to reason, given the fact that we are talking about, or partly going to talk about, the renovation of House of Kunst, that there should be rain. And because with the rain, it sort of reveals some of the challenges that this building faces. Not so much that the rain is going to wash away its history, but it's a reminder of the fact that even difficult structures like House of Kunst need ways of thinking about them, ways of also caring about them. And the purpose of a renovation is precisely to think some of these questions. And I'm not going to go too much into it because we have this evening the great architect, Sir David Chipperfield, here to engage us in an exploration of architecture, its meaning, its purpose, its value, its context, but more specifically, public architecture and the role of publicness in the construction of both civic but also social identity. And House of Kunst, with all its accumulated history, I will not call it baggage, but accumulated history, has been an institution that one could say over the last 70 years has been fundamentally a reflexive institution. And by reflexive, what I mean is an institution that functions with a deep awareness of its own historicity, a deep awareness of its responsibility to the present, to the contemporary, not simply the past. And it is not necessarily for us to sweep the past away, but, as I will oftentimes say, to think historically in the present. And this is the precise reason why the renovation is so meaningful and so important. But before I introduce our honored guest, I would like to use the opportunity to introduce another very honored person here, the State Minister, Dr. Ludwig Spaenle, under whose patronage this renovation is going to take place. Welcome, Dr. Spaenle.
Sehr geehrter Herr Enwezor, sehr geehrter Herr Sir Chipperfield, sehr geehrte Damen und Herren, welchen Platz hat das Haus der Kunst? Wo steht es? Banal gesagt an der Prinzregentenstraße 1. Aber welchen Platz hat dieses Haus in der Geschichte dieser Stadt? Welchen Platz hat dieses Haus und wird ihn in Zukunft einnehmen im Wettbewerb um einen der bedeutendsten Orte, die Kunst an der Zeitnaht zu präsentieren, in die Diskussion zu stellen? Welchen Platz nimmt dieses Haus mit seiner Historizität in seinem städtebaulichen Umfeld ein? Welcher Platz wird dem Westflügel eingeräumt sein? Welche Möglichkeiten ergeben sich? Ich glaube, dass viele Dinge neu gedacht werden müssen, vielleicht sogar ein Stück radikal gedacht sein müssen, um diese Chance, die der bauliche Zustand jetzt eben erfordert, nämlich die Chance der Renovierung, mit Innovation zu verbinden und das mit zwei Persönlichkeiten tun zu können, die ein unglaublich spannendes Geschehnis heute Abend ermöglichen. Das ist eine besondere Freude und Ehre. Und insofern sind wir gespannt, welchen Platz das Haus der Kunst in der nächsten Dekade einnimmt. Und ich freue mich, diesem wunderbaren Ereignis auch nicht mehr länger im Weg zu stehen. Schönen Abend.
Okay, it's obviously not my intention to speak on behalf of David Chipperfield, but you know, the process by which he got here started 3 years ago after a competition for the renovation of the building. And the reason why the jury that convened to look at the proposals chose Sir Chipperfield has to do with the rigor of thinking that underpinned the project that he brought to House of Kunst. It was not so much about architecture, but more about the context of the architecture. So, when we look at museums all over the world, I think that the issue we have to engage is precisely how does a museum stand in relation to the past, the present, and the future. And for House of Kunst, this has been an ongoing question. And we sometimes like to think of ourselves as a work in progress, as an institution in permanent transition. So the question is, how is this idea of permanent transition expressed? What are the modalities for transmitting that expression? The map of the world, literally and figuratively, is today distinctively different than it was in 1937 when this building first opened. In the last century, we have witnessed the rise and decline of great powers, the fall and rise of ideologies, and the emergence of new powers. But what has fundamentally changed the landscape of culture is globalization. And today, in the digital age, with the mass mobility of people and capital and the offshoring of labor and so on, we have to remind ourselves that museums are not just simply ceremonial places. They are social spaces, places that enables conversation between not simply the institution, but amongst the participants that come into the museum. And that is what we've been trying to think about how to activate in this building. So let me use the opportunity to introduce David Chipperfield, who is going to provide some insight into some of these questions based on his own work. So Chipperfield, whose buildings around the world have established an elegant and rigorous example of contemporary architecture, founded David Chipperfield Architects in 1985. His reconceptualization of historical buildings has led to aesthetically outstanding transformations that respect the integrity of the original structures and enhance the visitor's engagement with the spaces. With offices in London, Berlin, Milan, and Shanghai, Chipperfield Architects has designed museums and cultural institutions across the globe, including the highly lauded Neuss Museum on Berlin's Museum Island, the Museum of Modern Literature in Marbach am Neckar, the Hepworth Wakefield in West Yorkshire, the St. Louis Art Museum in the United States, the Turner Contemporary. Okay, it's a litany. In other words, it is to say that Sir Chipperfield has an impressive record of building museums. David Chipperfield Architects is also currently developing a master plan for London's Royal Academy of Arts, which has been located in the Burlington House since the 1830s and is slated to reopen in conjunction with the institution's 250th anniversary in 2018. Amongst the many honors of Sir Chipperfield, he was appointed Commander of the Order of the British Empire. I mean, coming from Nigeria, this is a little bit too much. The British Empire. A Royal Designer for Industry in 2006 and elected to the Royal Academy in 2008. In 2009, he was awarded the Order of Merit of the Federal Republic of Germany and was knighted for services to architecture in the United Kingdom and in Germany in 2010. And he was also awarded the Premium Imperial, which is Japan's highest honor for achievements in the arts. And prior to my going to Venice Biennale, Sir Chipperfield was also the artistic director of the Venice Biennale of Architecture. Please help me welcome.
So, I've learned a lot in the last 3 years that Okwui is not only very clever and very intelligent, always impeccably dressed, as you know, but excessively charming. And charmed me to come here tonight with the invitation that there would be just an informal talk, you know. We will just have a little conversation with some people and just explain. And maybe you can just show a few things about your work, and we can. So I'm here under the charmed invitation of Okwui, but we will talk together. But Okwui's asked me to, first of all, say a few things about our work on museums and about the ideas about what a contemporary art museum should be. Now, I think I have to go there, don't I? And can you hear me? Yes. So, before our conversation, I sort of would try and stimulate a few thoughts. First of all, some thoughts about, what is happening to museums, what a museum is, and of course, we know that traditionally a museum was a sort of temple, a treasure box, a place where cultivated people would go, and the museum, in a way, had a representation that was nearly more like a bank than it was a public building. This is the National Gallery in London. We know that over time, and especially as we moved into the 20th century, certain architects and certain institutions, and this is of course the National Gallery by Mies van der Rohe, one of the great museums, in a way a provocative museum. We are in the process of restoring this building at the moment. Provocative in the sense that it sort of suppressed the conventional aspect of the museum in terms of exhibition space. All of that hard work is happening, as it were, under the ground. And therefore, Mies, of course, was interested in making a piece of pure Miesian architecture. But also, it was it made another gesture, the idea that the museum was a sort of transparent institution. And that tendency found perhaps its most radical moment in another building which was very controversial, and you know, a lot of people hate it, but I think it's really an extraordinary moment in architecture, the Centre Pompidou by Richard Rogerson and Renzo Piano, in which the generation of, you know, 68 really managed in a strange moment of, as it were, holding power, convinced the French president and succeeding French presidents to build a museum that and a cultural institute that completely changed the notion of the building as a closed box. The building instead is a sort of fun palace, a place where it in a very extreme manner tried to deal with the idea of being popular. And in a way, this was probably the building that transformed the appeal of contemporary culture, not just by being more transparent or more accessible, but by representing this intention, by representing that culture is no longer behind the stone facades and the columned porticos, such as this building, of the traditional museum, but instead it's a building that has, as it were, total access. I would argue that the Pompidou Center was probably the last great radical piece of architecture, but of course its competitor probably, certainly in terms of museum architecture, is the Guggenheim by Frank Gehry in Bilbao. And while I would argue that while the Pompidou Center really transformed the very concept of a museum, in a way the Guggenheim in Bilbao transformed the idea of how a museum might look, I don't think it really transformed the concept of the museum itself. In fact, if anything, it's quite conservative in its idea that it's a treasure box again. It nearly is regressive in terms of the relationship to, if you compare it with the Pompidou Center. However, it is a sort of watershed in museum architecture for a number of reasons. First of all, within the language of architecture, of course, we know it generated a great enthusiasm for novel forms and for architecture to reconsider how architecture should look. But also, it became the sort of representative project that showed how culture could regenerate a city's fortunes. So Bilbao, which was a poor-looking and neglected industrial city, was put on the map by the Guggenheim building. And in a way, this is a sort of, you know, there's a sort of Pandora's box quality about this, because it became so successful. And by the way, the city of Bilbao had commissioned a series of very serious infrastructural improvements beyond just building a Guggenheim by Frank Gehry. There's a new subway, there were new housing projects, new public space. So, you know, it wasn't only the museum that did it, but the museum gave an identity to a city which had beforehand had a rather poor identity. It was certainly not a destination. And all of a sudden, one building, one museum, one fantastic, in the proper terms, piece of architecture could transform the destiny of this city. And it's introduced in this Pandora's box way the notion that the museum wasn't just the box that contained the art, but actually became part of the offer itself. Many people went to Bilbao because of the architecture, not because of the art, and that still pertains. And there's a very interesting fact, or at least I think a very sobering fact, that the building, the museum, the audience for the museum, only 14% of the audience comes from the local area. That's the Basque country. So from the city itself, it's probably less than 10% of the visitors of this building are from the city. And I think this is a sort of problem, and I think this is something that we should talk about a little bit, because I think museums, first of all, have to serve their constituency. This is not a criticism of the building, because I think, you know, it's an extraordinary building, and it's a great moment in architecture for lots of reasons, and it's a profound moment in museum architecture. Probably as profound in other ways was the opening up of Giles Gilbert Scott's powerhouse, a very unpopular building built after the war to compensate for the lack of energy that the city had. Built a power station next to the water opposite St. Paul's Cathedral. It was a very controversial building, but a building of a certain emergency. Nick Sirota, the director of the Tate at the time, was very keen to expand the remit of modern art. You have to consider at this point, in the 80s and 90s, one would have to say that the status of modern architecture, modern art, modernism, generally in England was really, you know, at quite a low point. And it now seems sort of easy, but the Tate Modern became a catalyst, and in a way, in the same way as Pompidou Center, created a very different relationship to the population. Now you can be critical of this. I mean, there is a sort of shopping mall quality a little bit. I mean, sometimes the Tate suffers from having too many visitors. I think it's more than 6 million visitors a year. I mean, it's a phenomenal success. And with a new extension, it is even more visited. And Nick Sirota recently, you know, sort of asked why he needed to extend the building. Explained that the museum is now a sort of general destination. People like to be here, he said. You know, people like to come here. And this is what he's trying to encourage. And I think that's a very interesting shift from the very purposeful nature of the museum in a very much more academic way to the museum, which is, for good or for bad, accepting our changing attitude to leisure and our desire for something more than just shopping and eating. So visiting museums has become, in a way, the third possibility. The great thing of the the Tate Modern was an accidental thing, was that the building was too big, and therefore the competition asked the architects, we were in that competition, to build, as it were, a smaller building within the building. And it wasn't quite clear what would happen with the rest. And Nick and Herzog Demeron, the architects, came up with this idea of programming this space, the turbine hall. So it's a combination of event space, display space, lobby, but public space. And it has been phenomenally successful and confirms this idea of the museum of contemporary art and the role of contemporary art, not just as something that you look at on the wall of a museum, but something that you experience. Contemporary art has moved away from only seeing art as being, you know, made by artists with paintbrushes and canvas. That, it, of course, it's still a very important aspect of contemporary art, but it's also looked for much wider and more engaged mediums of film, of installation, of large-scale pieces. And I think this is something which is also part of the appeal of contemporary art. Contemporary art has a very different potential than collections of historic work. having said that, I'm just, Okwui thought it would be good if I just showed some projects. I'm not really, this is not a review of all of our museums. We are working on a lot of projects. At the moment, as I said, we're restoring the Mises wonderful National Gallery in Berlin. We're constructing the Kunsthaus in Zurich. We're restoring, or we're adding to the Royal Academy in London, which is a wonderful project. And probably the crown in our jewel, or the project which is, of course, most exciting, is that we are rebuilding the contemporary and modern wing of the Metropolitan Museum in New York. And just saying that, the interesting thing is, why would the Met need to engage in contemporary art? You know, it doesn't have enough stuff already. I mean, it's got, it is this most extraordinary world, city of objects and art of all civilizations of all periods, in the same way at the British Museum. The reason that contemporary art is really being pushed by the Metropolitan Museum is because contemporary art has a very different relationship with audience than anyone else. You know, even the most wonderful Egyptian collections we have, I know there are two directors of Egyptian collections in the room. However wonderful those collections are, it's very difficult to imagine an audience going back to see an Egyptian collection more than once a year, even if that. So the traditional museum struggles with being, in a way, dynamic. The contemporary art museum doesn't have that struggle. It is, by definition, contemporary. Therefore, it's dealing with things of the everyday. It's dealing with things of now. And it finds it much easier to reach out. And I think, I'm sort of jumping ahead here a bit, but I think, of course, this is Okwui's vision of this building. And I think it's, you know, it's a most fantastic opportunity that within this shell, the opportunities, the dynamic as well as the static opportunities of contemporary art can be played out as a place to come, a place to be, and a place to discuss, a place to learn, a place to look. I'll just very briefly touch on a few other museums and say maybe the shortest words. This is the Museum of Art in St. Louis, an extension to a building, the last remaining pavilion of the 1903 World's Fair. Of course, as well as the dynamic, museums can't lose, they shouldn't lose their essential physical spirit, which is to offer a place of retreat, a place of concentration, a place of intensification. And in our project, we are very interested in what creates the circumstances within which art and the meaning of art and the physical experience of art can be intensified. Certainly, the idea of rooms, the space, is the first issue. And again, I would say, while this building carries many architectural problems with it, the generosity, the enormous generosity of the rooms in this building is an enormous asset for that. And normally this is, it's a quality we have to implant in our buildings, in modern buildings. This is St. Louis, where we are used the daylight. We're trying to make sure that in this wonderful park you get enough views outside of the building. Museums tend to be internal looking, insular, and of course, as a visitor, and for the art, of course, art, light is sort of dangerous, but for the visitor, in a way, we want to be a little bit separated from the world, but not totally. Going back to the point that museums now are also part of a notion of regeneration. We did two museums in Britain. This is the Hepworth Museum in Wakefield. The Hepworth Foundation generously donated a collection of casts from Barbara Hepworth's studio. Barbara Hepworth was born in this Yorkshire town. We had two great 20th century sculptors, Henry Moore and Barbara Hepworth. Henry Moore was born in Leeds, and Barbara Hepworth was born in Wakefield, both in Yorkshire and 20 miles apart from each other. It's a very interesting phenomenon. But both of these cities have sort of collapsed. They have collapsed economically and consequently, in a way, socially. And the desire was to optimistically, it's a Bilbao effect, I suppose, also desire to improve the fortunes of the city. I am very skeptical that that should be your primary reason, and I argued all the time, you must build a museum because you want to build a museum. You shouldn't build a museum because you think that it might increase the value of real estate. And I would have to say the program of the museum, the director has done an amazing job in the last 5 years, I think it's, no, even longer, that it's been open. They receive more than 350,000 visitors a year. This is in a country that apparently is not interested in modern art, it's not interested, apparently now we understand we're not interested in foreign things either after Brexit, that we have closed minds and the people of the north of England have even more closed minds. So it's extraordinary that a provincial museum should receive more than 350,000 visitors a year. At the same time, we have a saying in England or in London, you wait for an hour for a bus to come and then two come. And it was the same for us. We hadn't done any public projects in England for 15, 20 years, and then all of a sudden we had two. And the second one was inspired with exactly the same notion of regeneration. However, in both cases, there was a seed of a museum or an institution already existing. This is Margate on the coast of Kent. It's a very peculiar and particular place. It's exactly where the River Thames comes into the North Sea, Margate, the gate of the sea. And actually, it means that, and it's on the south coast of the Thames, so very strangely, you look north to the water. And it's also unusual in the sense that the sun sets, you know, on the water. Tradition, I mean, the dominant marine environments, the coastal environments in Britain, tend to be on the south coast, and we somehow, as an island, tend to gravitate to looking across the channel, even if we're too frightened to cross it. So the light and the relationship between the town and the water and the light is phenomenal. And this is where Turner was born, went to school, left, and then in later years came back and pronounced these as being the loveliest skies in the whole of Europe. And so he painted here. He also had an affair with the landlady of the hotel that this building replacement was on the site. So we're not quite sure whether it was the loveliest skies in Europe or his relationship with his landlady, but or probably both. And Margate used to be the sort of working class holiday destination for people from London, especially. This would be the English seaside for people from the East End of London, especially. And then, of course, in the 80s, 70s and 80s, and then it became much more cheap to go to. It was just as cheap to go to Spain, to the Mediterranean, than it was to go here. And so the fortunes of Margate absolutely collapsed. And the place has phenomenally difficult social issues. It has no real economy. And therefore, building this building here, the expectation would be that it would change, would try and arrest this. But again, I would say in both cases, I was very adamant that, you know, these buildings are built for art, and that you must take that seriously. It's no good having building a museum that has not a relationship with the program, that doesn't consider how you will run such an institution. For instance, the building is essentially a number of simple north-facing studios with the light coming from the sea, this wonderful light, and they are rooms. And so the idea was that you wouldn't have to spend any money installing. You can put a nail in the wall and hang a painting, or you could just put. So there was a sort of defensive attitude as to how this building could, and the same in Wakefield, remain relevant for the community, not just rely on the idea of attracting tourism. Tourism is something which you might get on top. You will get on top. But to get tourism and then try and get your local constituency is really difficult. But building your local constituency, making this a building, making these buildings really for the community first, is profoundly important. And that whether it's St. Louis or in Alaska or Des Moines or Wakefield, in all of these cases, it's been very interesting to see how the communities that you somehow think would not embrace contemporary art. I mean, you can imagine how difficult, it was foreseen that people from this area would walk into a museum and see the work of Tracy Emin, or who actually comes from Margate. And yet, it's really, I mean, again, this tiny building, which cost less than 20 million euros, has a visitor number of more than 300,000 people. So that's, of course, it's a tribute to the architecture, but actually it's not. It's a tribute to the programming and to the way that the museum has made itself relevant to the community. I didn't really need to put this in. I'm going to flip on. I mean, yeah. So very briefly, before I talk about Haus der Kunst, just a diversion from contemporary art into the museum island, although this is viewed from the gallery house of Heiner Bastian, looking towards the Neues Museum, the you can see the Altersmuseum on the right-hand side, and at this point, a hole in front where the James Simon Gallery is now coming. Yeah. The wrong sequence, it was meant to be. Okay, another museum, just to talk about, this is Mexico City, contemporary collector who wanted to move, a fantastic contemporary collection of Mexican art. He was very big collector of the young generation of Mexican artists, and in fact, in a way, the Mexican art scene, really owes him an enormous amount. He really supported all of the new generation. His museum before was outside of the city. He wanted to move inside the city. But at the same time, he was nervous that this would become a sort of elitist building of a private collector. So we tried very hard to, as it were, deprivatize a private building. And essentially, the two top floors are the galleries. So the top floor, of course, is a top-lit gallery. The floor below is in them. Those are the two hard-working static spaces. The two lower floors are there only to create a relationship between the public and the building. So the building, as it were, stretches out. And the first instance, you can imagine in Mexico City, making public spaces not easy. So we try to make this part of the museum. And in a way, there is no door. So when you step here, you are sort of in the museum. Apparently there's no door here. So the next threshold is, as it were, going under the sort of skirt of this building. And then because of the climate of Mexico, the very benign climate of Mexico City, these doors, this lobby can nearly be totally open. And then the first floor is dedicated to being a space of public interaction. And there is this sort of, I can show you here, you can just see there is this sort of glass box. The idea was to ensure that as well as the static offer of the exhibition, which is on the top two floors, the lower floors are always having activity. And of course, we know that the coffee shop and the bookshop give a certain public offer, but actually it's not really enough. So in this building, we added this sort of unnecessary element, which is a room which is not a lecture hall, it's not a performance space, it's not an exhibition hall, it's not kitted out specifically for any of those things, but can do all of them. So, because the thing is, if you say it's going to be an auditorium, then you need all of the things. And this is something we'll come back to here. The idea of a room which can take the communal and common events, the things which keep a museum alive, the things which are not just the passive and protected relationship between you and the artworks, but actually those collective moments of dialogue, of performance, and things like that. And we were very nervous about whether this was going to be a complete wasted space. And in fact, on the opposite, it's become really the dynamic heart of the building, as well as, of course, weddings on Saturday nights and different things, but it allows really a sort of public intervention to the building. And then when we go upstairs, the classic rooms. So very briefly, the museum island, I don't talk about this in terms of contemporary art so much, more in terms of the issues that we have here in relationship to a building which is loaded with history. And I'm not going to go through, everyone knows really the story of this building, of how complicated it was intellectually, emotionally, and physically to bring together the issues that would allow us to protect in a sort of secular manner, in a way we described our role as being responsible for the building, that we became the sort of guardians of the building, understanding its traumatic history, and trying to do, as it were, what's best for the building, to act on behalf of the building. And that was really our concern. And of course, intellectually, the argument was that we should keep everything that had survived, because you could talk about this as a consequence of destruction, but you could also talk about it as a sort of optimism of survival. And of course, this is how culture is so important, and in Germany, why contemporary culture has been so important to the country since the war. And so finally, the extension of the museum island, the new entrance building here, the James Simon Gallery. And it was, when we won the competition for the Noise Museum, it was foreseen that because the Noise Museum was completely bombed, that in the rebuilding, it could accommodate all of the bits and pieces that the museum island didn't have. Changing exhibition, a better restaurant, a larger shop, auditorium, things like this. We argued after we won the competition that you cannot restore Noise Museum and put these things inside it. It would destroy the building and would give us no chance of looking after the building. And therefore, it was accepted that those elements, plus, in a way, a sort of common entrance, would be put in a new building here. And the difficulty was how to, first of all, the two things. One is, how do you build a modern building in such a historic environment? And secondly, how do you give an identity to a building which is not really a museum, but it's a sort of infrastructure? And I showed this image because one of the genius ideas of the master plan, the original master plan, is this Kolonnadenhof, because Schinkel's building is here. The subsequent buildings of National Gallery and Noise Museum are sort of behind. So Stuhler's concept was to create this new square garden, which is in a way reorientates you towards these two entrances. Of course, when the Pergamon came, this thing doesn't work anymore. So what we've done is to think about our building as a continuation of the colonnade. And here you can see, rather like Mies van der Rohe's National Gallery, the hard work is being done underground, and the above ground is trying to be a place. It's not trying to be a museum, because it's not. It's trying to be a place of gathering and meeting and coordination and, in a way, a sort of front door for mass tourism. You will still be able to enter the Pergamon, the Noise Museum, Alten Museum, and Bode separately, but this will take away the pressure of the mass tourism. And here you see a sort of image of this idea of the Sockel being continuation of the Pergamon, making the building sit in the water, as so much of the museum island does, as the Pergamon does. In that Sockel are all the functions, and then rather like on the rest of the island, whether it's the portico of the Altes Museum, or the portico of the National Gallery, or the grand steps of the National Gallery, or The architecture comes from these things and presents itself as, as it were, public. So we were very interested in the idea that the building really made a public offer, that its program, it became programmatically sort of passive, that you, it doesn't push its program very hard, that it becomes first and foremost a place. And now it's being, it's rising out of the ground, looking rather similar to what the computer images do. So, Haus der Kunst. Very briefly, I just want to explain the fundamental ideas and issues to do with the project. They really separate into two halves, but the central concern, of course, is how to make the museum relevant to the city, how to bring how to make this a house of contemporary art. Picking up on the themes I've already established, and this is something which, you know, Okwui has really been talking very strongly about, the idea that a contemporary art museum is both exhibition space in terms of the static and spaces where activities happen, the sort of dynamic. This is the potential of a contemporary art museum, and this is at the heart of Okwui's vision for how this building should operate, and very specifically, the future of the West, this West Wing where we sit now. We know how well situated the building is within the structure of the city. It's in a fantastic location. We also know that it's been neglected. We know that physically it needs repair, and regardless of program or concept or any other issue, it has to be renovated and repaired. So there are, you know, this is just normal repair stuff. This is what has to happen to the building, whatever happens. And it's not, it's not unusual that this should be the case. We know that this building is really in a prime situation because we can see it on the map and we can see it from the air, but we actually can't see it from the street. And of course, the history of the building since the war in some ways has been one of sort of punishing the building, of covering the building up, to put a curtain in front of it. This is a completely understandable history, understandable action. But it leaves us, I think, with a question that if the Haus der Kunst is to become really, you know, a major institution within the fabric of the city, if it's going to take on a really profound meaning, then we sort of have to come to terms with our confusions about its historical meanings. That it's not easy to say the Haus der Kunst is really important and keep these curtains, to keep this building sort of humiliated. And so it opens a question, first of all, how can this building, which has been, as it were, isolated from the city as a building, be brought back into the city? If you want to bring the institution really and make it such an important part of Munich, which it could be, I mean, imagine, you know, such a contemporary art center, I mean, sitting in such a place. I mean, every city would die for this amount of space of this quality and with the idea, the programmatic idea that there is. Imagine this being, you know, there. But at the same time, it's a sort of strangeness that as a piece of architecture, it's sort of not there. So how do we live with this contradictory thing of bringing the building back into the city, but in a way, still keeping it hidden. Because clearly, it had a very different urban position. It had a very different presentation. And we know why this is contaminated in a way. We know why emotionally it was dealt with in the way it was, not only in terms of planting the trees in front, but also the refiguration of the steps. This is how it was in 1939, the staircase in front. This is how we are now, where, I'm gonna go one ahead, I think, yeah, here. So you could see that there was a space, you know, the column sat on a platform, on a socle, and this allowed a sort of penetration into the building, a transparency into the building, even though, you know, its austerity is strong, it did allow that. And now, of course, we have a sort of 1.2 meter high, 1.4 meter high wall. So this removing the stairs is not just a matter of removing the symbolism of the stairs, it also removes the friendliness in a way, or the openness of the building. And putting the trees also hides the building. So this is an issue I think is not easy to avoid. We have to also say the same is true in terms of the relationship to the English garden. You know, this is the view from the English garden to the museum. You can't see it. It's not, you know, it's gone. So it's another curtain, you know, it's another attempt to hide the building. And this wonderful relation that the building had, because it's sort of like an English country house. The English country house, you approach, you come through the building, and then you arrive on the balcony, and you look over the landscape. That's how this building was, and this is what we have. Now, we know trees and cars are probably the two most sensitive elements you can ever talk about in urban planning. So I apologize that we go straight to the matter on this, but cars and trees are part of this problem. And of course, you know, this is how this could be, or it was. This very, you know, idyllic relationship between amazing town. I mean, even now, I mean, it's a wonderful place to be, even with the cars and even with the tree curtain. And but, you know, I love this image here. You can see, you know, here's a, it could be the English countryside. It looks exactly like, you know, Capability Brown or something. And in a way, this is the quality of the building, the relationship. So there are these two issues. The relationship to the city on one side, how does the building, and in a way, from inside to the out, the relationship to the park. How are you rewarded by coming through the building and arriving at this balcony and having this extraordinary view? So, you know, is there a chance of going from this to something more like that? Not, I would say, in this case, not that it's important to see the building from the park, but it's very important to see the park from the building. I think on the other side, it's a different thing, the relationship to the city. if we go inside, I think you start to realize how important this discussion is to the whole future of the institution. That this cross-axis of coming from the street, this public, this generous public route, which could take you through, and at the moment lands you in a very ambiguous space here, which is for rent, and is always somehow undressed, and then to a terrace, which is also always in a sort of provisional moment, overlooking a car park. How wonderful would it be to reestablish a sort of strong urban relationship through the building with the two incredible blocks of activity, you know, galleries on the one hand, and where we are now, this new, what we call the universal stage, this idea of rooms for performance and activity. And again, I would have to say, while the building has, you know, is contaminated by its history, in terms of its core planning, it's quite clever. You know, it's not so stupid. It's a
this is a wonderful
organization of rooms. I mean, it's, you know, every museum would be jealous of spaces like this, so easily connected.
At the moment, there is a sort of weakness that these are the offices, and we think that you could reorganize the offices in another place and put shops and
education and more public things to try and make that frontage more. And of course, then
you can see sort of three or four buildings in here. These two blocks, the machinery, in a way, the factory. Production here, and then these two edges, one edge to the city and one edge to the park. And the edge to the park should be, you know, inspired by the Golden Bar. You know, this should all be
about that part of the program a museum increasingly wants, which is
a place to be, a place to have a coffee, a place for informal talking, a place for meeting. And this should be infrastructure which is related to the public.
And the machine in the middle. So we're interested in bringing people through,
and we're interested in
animating this central hall. So first of all, we think that we need to a little bit, we can't change the size of the opening, but maybe the generosity of the Vinfang could be increased. And then secondly, what can we do with the central hall to make it more lively and more spirited? We could
certainly open again these windows, which would, because we want to put
program
up here, education on one side and exhibition on the other, and we could
bring back the skylight. I think in those two simple operations, we could make this space better. Then the next space,
which I think is very critical to the whole thing, is that if you keep this axis, then we have to make this room a public room.
And we have to think about how that can always be an access to the back, especially
if we can make this vista
and this condition better than it is now. So this is how that room is. I mean, it's always in a state of sort of undress. So could we not animate more by opening
the balconies, by opening the skylight?
Quite modest things, not profound changes, you know, restoring the space a bit better, but that's and then in terms of the diagram, the master plan,
you can see that it has a sort of
very clear logic
with the exhibition here, the Universal Buna here, and the sort of terrace and the, let's call it, recreation here, and the public interface here.
It's nearly an ideal museum plan. And in order for that to happen, this is the room towards the terrace that could become a sort of lounge. I mean, we're in discussing this with Okwui and his team about what can be the reality of this, but the idea that it's that on one side is the restaurant, the other side is the bar and the Golden Bar, and this is a sort of flexible space, but like a members' lounge, but in a way everybody can use it, and it becomes an informal space and totally open to the terrace. So it's the space before the terrace.
And that shows you that concept. And then into this, well, into, let's talk about the exhibition spaces. So there's the heart of the project, with obviously the exhibitions on the east side, and what we call the sort of universal stage in this room. We don't really need that much more exhibition space. We can provide that exhibition space on the first floor. Here, we'd like to make this, Okwui would like to make this into archive research, so increase the sort of educational aspect, and of course we've got the existing exhibition in the basement. So when it comes to this room, what can be the future of it? We think that it should be put back as a room. It shouldn't be specifically anything. It shouldn't be, a music auditorium. It shouldn't be a performance. It should, like I was trying to explain in the Mexico project, that it's a space which can be used under many different forms. Yeah. I don't have the other. Sorry, we don't have the other. Okay, we have to take that. That we can. Don't know where. Sorry, we've lost the slides on this. Essentially, we have a great advantage that we have two entrances, one from the outside and one from the inside. So this hall can be used for lectures or conferences or performances, and either it's being entered off the museum, and this is the ante space before, so like an evening night tonight, we would come off of that hall. That's where the shop is. The shop would move over here. But at the same time, if it was rented out for conference, then you can still maintain this entrance and these support spaces in combination. So that became, this is a sort of, I think this is the final image, just showing how this room becomes what's been termed as the universal stage that allows the program of contemporary art to fulfill itself in other ways that are not being fulfilled in the exhibition rooms. And also, of course, it can host various activities, whether that's music, performance, or conference. I think that's the last image. Okwui.
Wow, David, that was a very, precise and informative procession of context, moving from a kind of 19th century idea of the temple to this machine for visibility, of transparency, that of Ms. van der Rohe, and of course, the what I will call the kind of organism that the Centre Pompidou is, and of course, the Loch Ness monster that's Bilbao. So all the institutions you've shown are principally institutions of the either recent historical past, but also institutions that in many ways are responding to changes that are taking place across the world. And that is the pressure of cities to accommodate, different constituencies, and on the other hand, the pressure on depopulated places to create value, social value, cultural value. And I wonder, in a context like Germany or Munich, where one can certainly say there is a surplus of institutions. How can a museum, you know, develop that kind of distinctiveness where it remains located in its locality, but at the same time signifies all the kind of pressures that all the cities that you've pointed out are dealing with? Can you talk a little bit about that relationship between the surplus that a place like Munich has? There are so many institutions, and what Hause Kunst can be.
Well, I mean, you can probably say it better than I can, but you know, it seems at the moment, you know, we are at a moment when two tendencies are crossing and sort of, in a way, related. One is the museum generally as an increasing part of our leisure time. That we increasingly want destinations that we increasingly are looking for that. That seems to be one thing. The second trajectory is the strange and growing popularity and importance of contemporary art. You know, who would have expected that? Who would imagine that people in Margate or in Yorkshire would come in their thousands to see exhibitions, which I have to say sometimes are quite challenging and provocative. And I think what's clearly, it's one of the, and I think now these two things are feeding from each other, that the artists are realizing that they, in order to, as it were, feed this interest, their work has to somehow rise to it. They have to take on issues more than just color and composition. But they are taking increasingly. Now, you could say that, you know, shouldn't they stay painting on canvas? I mean, do we really want artists to, fill rooms with oil or do all sorts of other strange things? But I think it means that the Contemporary Art Museum has become a sort of forum. I mean, and I think sometimes it's rubbish. I mean, I have to admit that I find myself standing in certain exhibitions, I think it's complete and utter rubbish. I have no idea how to get close to it. It doesn't necessarily appeal to me, but the forum, I think, is always interesting. So I think, you know, what we're seeing now is the greater relevance of the Contemporary Art Museum, which 30 years ago I would never have imagined.
Some people will look at, you know, the your plans for Hause Kunst and say, why not dynamite the building? It's been said repeatedly. What kind of case can you make for an architecture like this that is so loaded, so, you know, historically freighted with all kinds of interpretations and projections? I suppose maybe being outsiders, you and I, we have a completely different feeling. I tend to say that these are proper rooms. Artworks look great in the rooms. And yet, there's a great deal of lack of sympathy for that. How can we ameliorate this tension?
But if you take the green rooms, they're not contaminated in a way. I mean, they're loosely contaminated, but you know, they are just great spaces, and they, in a way, they are modeled on 19th century gallery rooms. They're top lit, very tall spaces, which, you know, are perfect for art. You know, there is something very, very interesting about spaces that have no scale. They are somehow
formless.
Yeah, they are. When you walk around those rooms,
the architecture goes away. You're in a sort of abstract. It's very abstract. So I think the contamination and the architectural problem is not in the green things. It's in the two strips either side, if you like. No, it's, I mean, let's be clear. It's the bunch of columns on both sides of the building. You know, it's as simple as that in some ways. And therefore, you know, it would be difficult, I think, to say that this building is, you know, if you started the other way around, let's imagine the green space here was completely useless for exhibition, and you're sitting here as a museum director saying, David, I just don't know how to use them. I've got no idea how to use these spaces. Mm. Plus, we've got a building that everyone sort of hates from the outside. Mm. Okay, that's another thing. But actually, I know every museum director in the world would like this suite of rooms.
I certainly do, but on a certain level, though, I think that there is a great question that we have to confront, which is the, you know, the proliferation, the just the massive proliferation of museums, and is there something that one can do to arrest this condition? Is renovation the one way to arrest this condition? And if that is the case, what might be the new model for the 21st century? Because you've shown us the 19th century model of institutions. We saw the 20th century model culminating with destination, you know, architecture, which you say is a fantastic, you know, museum. So what is the model, you know, for the 21st century?
I think the first issue is that it should be primarily meaningful to the community. I think it has to be embedded with the community. And again, I would say this is another interesting thing which has come out of conversations at the Metropolitan Museum. Increasingly, you know, when I give this figure of the Guggenheim in Bilbao as, you know, less than 10% of people coming from the old city, I gave a lecture to museum directors about this, and Nick Sirota came to me afterwards and said, we don't talk about this too much, but we have exactly the same problem. We are the balance between people from London and destinational tourists is getting too much out of sync. Therefore, museums have to, first of all, have their constituency in mind, which is to be relevant to the community, to provide this facility for the younger generation and for a generation, any generation that's interested in contemporary art and discussion that goes around contemporary world. Interestingly, for instance, on the Met, when people are saying, but why is the Met interested in contemporary art? You know, they've just got great Islamic collection. The interesting idea also is that contemporary art will form a stronger relationship with the city than any other art. It's more likely that people living in New York will go to the contemporary art wing than they will to go again to other parts of the museum. So it's interesting how, let's take in the Metropolitan Museum's case, the idea of the contemporary art wing is, of course, to expand the responsibility of the collection towards the contemporary, which it's always been. But also, it's about an appeal to the city, because people don't come into museums in other ways. The converse exists, of course, because if you're a tourist coming from Munich, you first of all want to go to the Pinakothek and you want to go to all of the historic collection. I mean, as a tourist, you would tend to do that. And that's why I think it's important that museums don't, first of all, get overexcited about tourism. Tourism will come. Once this becomes, a famous contemporary art center, as it will, people will come and look at it. But it's for this institution to be meaningful, it's got to be meaningful to the community. And that's where the architecture problem starts. Because it can only be meaningful to the community if the community also adjusts its ideas towards the meaning of the building. And this is something very important. And I think we had a conversation earlier that when you think of what Germany's done since the war in using culture as a way of strengthening itself again and reforming itself and re-representing its values. I mean, culture has been absolutely central. I mean, as an Anglo-Saxon, I'm so jealous always and so excited about how profoundly important culture is in Germany compared to, I have to admit, you know, in England. You know, in Wakefield and Turner, the politicians had no interest whatsoever. These projects were done really against the system.
That's why we have the minister here.
Yeah. He's, I'm sorry.
He's very interested. He's very engaged.
In England, we wouldn't have a minister at this. I mean, they're not interested. There is nobody in the House of Commons has any interest in contemporary art. We have a minister of culture that has no background whatsoever. It's a prerequisite that you don't have any interest in the arts. So I think that, because you asked me before, how can one deal with this building? And I was saying, you have to remember that how, and this is a sort of, I think, a problem for architecture, you have to think how agile painting, sculpture, music, literature has been in this post-war period. And funny enough, architecture is the one that never, you know, it's always, you know, a few miles behind, never catching up. It's always running behind saying, yeah, but you know, we're trying. It's very unagile. And therefore, in a way, this building is still carrying concerns that I don't think it should anymore. It's not easy to wipe the building clean. But at the same time, I think it has to happen at some point, you know. It's not relevant. It doesn't make sense to knock this building down. So at some point, it has to be, you know, reaccepted into the community. And when will that be? Why can't that be now?
Well, I have quite a number of other questions, but I think we are getting on time, and I just want to maybe give the public an opportunity to you know, pose a few questions. And if there are any questions, it doesn't have to be related to House of Commons, you know, please feel free.
I wonder why you talk a lot about history and contamination, but you both seem to be shy just to name it. And I really wonder, I mean, it's Nazi architecture. I mean, this building was the first large architectural building Hitler wanted to have. And I really wonder whether, how Hitler would think about it, about your program. I mean, he would, excuse me, he would just love to hear what you say about this building. Doesn't this give you a little bit of shivers?
You can talk about architecture for all generations. I mean, what about, you know, Victorian architecture in England, which is built from the wealth of, you know, the exploitation of the colonies, or whatever. I mean, there's still, there are all sorts of you know, architecture is always related to power. It can't be built without power. And of course, that power is subject to abuse. And some of those abuses are extreme abuses to society. The question is, can we discuss, I mean, are we at a point where, given that we can discuss things
in literature, we can discuss things in art. Why can't this building be discussed? Why does it have to only be seen in one way? And in one sense, you could say it's also the place where the whole concept of degenerate art collapsed. You know, it didn't work. You could say this is an intense ground. It is a battleground. You know, it's a cultural battleground. It's infused with, you know, the wrong, you know, it was invented for the wrong idea. But we don't, it's not a threat anymore. Therefore, do the bricks still carry that? Does the stone still carry that? I'm not sure it does any more than you could say, a building by, headquarters of an oil company is probably easily challenged as well for what it does to the environment, you know, what that company does to the environment or whatever. We can't blame buildings all the time. You know, this is an issue of human performance. Now, if you say this building can never recover from the stigma of association, you're right, then you have to blow it up. But I'm not sure that architecture, you know, has to carry that responsibility. But if it doesn't, you're absolutely right, you have to articulate it. We're not shy of calling it a Nazi building at all. I mean, we're not shy at all. That's a complete misunderstanding. I mean, otherwise we wouldn't be talking about it. And we're more than familiar with the complexity. And I certainly wouldn't underestimate that while there are intellectual logics that the emotional dimension is never to be underestimated, you know. And I learned this in Berlin on Noise Museum. You can intellectually be doing the right thing, but that you cannot do that. You have no right to only follow an intellectual direction without understanding all of the emotional arguments, which can't be argued in the same way. And I think it's the same here. I would argue that intellectually, everything I've said is correct, that it doesn't make sense that a bunch of trees that were planted to hide it are still there, because this is not a convincing act of history. I mean, it's not, you know, I mean, for heaven's sake, what are you trying to pretend? That the building's not there? Of course it's still there. The trees don't change whether it's there or not. You could say, yes, but we don't have to look at it. Well, that's not very substantial. That's not anymore, in my opinion, a valid reason to have the trees there. I think you either have to knock it down or expose it and say, we don't need the trees anymore. You know what? We are brave enough to face this without the trees. Therefore, I think that the intellectual argument of this building has the potential of being reinvented, if you like, cleansed, by becoming a center of contemporary art, because contemporary art now is to the point. Contemporary art deals with issues, and I think that's what's interesting about it. I think if you made it a museum of Islamic art, or you made it a museum of 19th century paintings or something, I think it would be much more difficult. I think the contemporary art program really helps confront this. I think from the point of view of the program, which then also expands to the idea that this building has to refine its position in the city. Intellectually, in my opinion, is completely correct. But I completely accept that there's a big but. How do you deal with the emotional, layer? Deep emotional thing. And you can't do it by saying it's not there. And I agree with you on that, but I still... I don't think that the alternative of blowing it up is a valid one.
Well, David has said everything I wanted to say, so I will pass over to the next questioner. There are several.
Thank you very much, Sir David, for this inspiring talk. I'm a development economist, and a lot of my work takes place in the Palais des Nations in Geneva, which is very similar architecture-wise to the Haus der Kunst in that it dwarfs humans. And it's from the 1930s, similar period. So to me, the architecture of the Haus der Kunst is not the problem, it's the history of what happened inside, as you're also saying. So that's the cleansing act that needs to take place. But I have a different question. I was struck by your saying that the museum needs to be anchored in the community. And you were saying that in these cities that you mentioned or these towns, 10% of the visitors are from the community and the rest are from elsewhere. But the question is, how many percent of the community are coming? You know, what's the base? So if the community is small, then 10% of the museum visitors might be 100%
of the town.
That
could be everybody in the village, yes. Yeah, but in the case of Bilbao, it's not. It's a very small. Oh, no, there, I would say the opposite. We've managed. The reason that those buildings are visited are because the community goes there. They've become community buildings. I mean, the interesting thing that when you're in smaller communities, it's much easier to find that bridge. So we did a building in St. Louis. I showed the building in St. Louis. During the process, the director and myself, did events like this, but we did about 10 of them through the whole process because it was necessary for the community to somehow agree that the museum was going to be built. Because in America, it's a philanthropic economy. So you depend on people from the community giving $1 million, $2 million. You know, in that case, we had to raise $121 million. Those people don't give it if they think that the community is not in favor of the project. So what's very interesting, in both cases, I would say, both in the English examples and in the American examples, the desire and need, and maybe the will, to reach out through education programs, through all sorts of methods, which are not just opening the doors and waiting for people to come in. You know, in England, you can't get any money from government unless you demonstrate how hard you're working to engage with community. And you would never get, you imagine, 350,000 people in Margate. I mean, you saw that. It's a tiny little town. I mean, that's a huge amount of the population and a huge number of visitors. And you only get that if you are bringing school groups in, getting onto the curriculum, and doing things like that. That's something that's very, I would say that working with Anglo-Saxon institutions is really difficult because it's so fragile in turn. But I would say the one thing which is interesting as a sort of strange consequence is this need for the institution to become valid to the community, because without that, they won't get supported. Whereas in Germany, you've got a bit more security. You know, once the state says, okay, there's a museum, you've got the museum, there's your money, therefore, there is slightly, you know, good and bad, but certainly the only thing I can say that's positive about the Anglo-Saxon system is this sort of slightly more energetic thing of making sure that the institution is valid to the community.
Well, I can certainly say that Haus der Kunst, and I can't speak for other museums in Munich, that our visitors are mostly from Munich and the surrounding area. Our challenge are the tourists, the visitors from elsewhere. So the proportion of visitors that come here are repeat visitors. So there is, in a sense, a very strong identification, here. You know, there is, a strong, sense of possibility. I don't quite say place, and what we are really discussing today is how to create that sense of place, to have this building even more better located within the bloodstream of the city, including the visitors that are, you know, coming into the city. I mean, to the point of the gentleman about really not mentioning that this is a nasty building. I think with all due respect, I think, you know, he must have missed the boat several times. Of course, it's a building constructed by the Nazis, and one cannot work with an awareness of that history here. Yeah. Well, or being, you know, with the awareness of that history and ignore the fact that we need to constantly think about that. But like David said, my sense is that buildings have no subjectivity. You can't endlessly put them on trial. So it's important to that you also take into consideration that successive generations of leadership of this institution has precisely engaged that history in numerous ways. My predecessor, Chris Deacon, launched something called critical reconstruction, and it was and lots of debates, you know, were organized here with other architects who came to talk about it. And prior to that, you know, Christoph Vitali, you know, also engaged the history of this building. But the question is that what point do we really stop dancing around in circles, because knocking it down doesn't really solve the problem. If you knock it down, what do you put on top of it? Whatever you put on top of it is, oh, this was the ground where the Nazis built. So I think that what we've done with our archive gallery, with exhibitions that we've organized, is to continue to think critically about our responsibility to engage in history. And in a certain sense, what makes Haus der Kunst precisely appealing is because it was constructed as an anti-modernist project. And so it's precisely the anti-modernism of the building that makes it attractive today, because it's the opposite. In 1937, in the speech given by the patron of this building, who shall remain unnamed, he said that we are not constructing this building, I'm almost quoting it verbatim, for no international art of the year 1940, 1950, and 60. That is a building being constructed for the German people. So it was a building that was precisely constructed to be ahistorical, you know, emptied of any engagement with time, emptied with any engagement with the possibility of change. It was kind of fixed in a sense. And what has happened in the history that today we are speaking precisely about contemporaneity, about the international. We are thinking about the present, and we're thinking about the future. And what more powerful way can one sort of really engage and confront history in a responsible, critical way? And you do it with an awareness that no building, no matter how well-intentioned, is perfect. Buildings, even the ones that we love, fall into disrepair. They become obsolete. They grow out of stylistic favor. You know, we know those piles of concrete in London, you know, Hayward and so on, the so-called brutalist architecture. But I think there is something to really to think about the value of the ideas underpinning some of those buildings. And what we are trying to do here is not necessarily to renovate the building, but to see if there's an opportunity for cultural innovation. Munich isn't what it was in 1937. So we cannot pretend working in this building. I don't walk into this building and feel shivers. I feel that there is a sense of justice in a way of taking back this building and giving it back to the future.
We use this building for wonderful events. There were fashion parties, and whenever we crossed the doors of this building, we didn't think about our Nazi past. We were very much aware of it, out of this generation in the 68s. But once we were here, we enjoyed the building. It was a temple of joy for quite a while. It somehow lost. And I think the building itself deserves fantastically shown at the Ai Weiwei exhibit. One would have thought it couldn't be anywhere else. I just want to contribute that.
Well, the problem is it's easier to use something in a provisional manner because the meaning doesn't have a profound. As soon as it becomes, in a way, part of the state, then of course it takes on another meaning. It's not a cuckoo's nest anymore. It's something which you use. But I also think that, the counterpoint between the sort of formality and the pretensions of the building and the informality of contemporary art and the idea that things happen inside it, I think is a very, very, potent image. And I think of the ICA in London. I mean, the ICA in the 60s, 70s, 80s was a very, very important, probably one of the most important institutions in London. And it was in, a classical building on the Mall, on axis with the Buckingham Palace. It was the wrong architecture for an institute of contemporary art. But actually, the paradox was very energetic.
Time I come here, I wonder, because there is still this ornament, this mosaic in the entrance hall, right, with the swastika. So I was wondering whether this will be removed or whether this is plan of the renovation program to remove this, because it's really strange that this symbol is still so obvious in this building.
you mean in the arcade? Well, this building is called Denkmal Schutz, so I have no say in that. But in an interesting way, I think we can begin by stripping the building bit by bit, mosaic by mosaic, brick by brick, and so on. What one has to avoid is also sanitizing the building, because that will be giving the building a kind of false consciousness in a sense, without making any apologies for what you see outside. So it's a remnant, it's a ruin in a sense, well preserved, that we, particularly don't really pay attention to. But if you look, if you walk into the building and see this installation by Christian Boltanski, with the faces, from the so-called Rote Kapelle, and the also the asphalt on the ground by Gustav Metzger, who was born in Nuremberg, in the 20s and was one of the first group of young Jewish kids that were shipped out of Germany And Metzger is nearly, you know, he's about nearly 90, lives in London, and that those two pieces, this confrontation, you know, of Boltanski's work, this intervention into the architecture, and the and Metzger's piece, you know, called Travertin Judenpesch, is precisely, you know, what makes this place very, very interesting, and that is that the artists themselves are not afraid of confronting, you know, these symbols, but making of the symbols, you know, transforming, you know, these symbols, producing new meaning, bringing us, you know, to the present, and we've made it our task to continuously engage contemporary artists to help us think the architecture, in a sense, to think what we will call the archival unconscious, and this is precisely the reason why, you know, we are, you know, very, very much, you know, interested in this renovation, because it's an opportunity to turn the building over to international artists. And you know, since I started working here, the one thing that I constantly say, exhibitions look better here, because the artists love the rooms for some reason. They love putting their work in the rooms, and again, it's always a challenge, you know, to be in a building that is part of the Hauptstadt, the Bewegung. But in a lot of Munich is, we can't go around condemn the ZE, the Musical Academy, and so on. I think we need to think a little bit more powerfully. Yeah.
I think the other thing that you, in your introduction, Okwui talked about the institution being, you know, reflective. And I think that's what contemporary art and literature and music has done in Germany in these years. And it remains. You know, everything does have more meaning here. And in, coming from the Anglo-Saxon world, where I don't think we are sufficiently reflective, I think this is something, you know, very powerful, and that's why culture, in a way, is more important. Of course, the arts generally are quite agile. They can reflect, and they can represent, and they can change, and they can mirror, or, you know, they have an ability. But architecture doesn't, and this is the problem with this building, are we saying that it should have somehow reflected this history? It can't. It's here, and so this is one of the problems for architecture. It's not a medium of comment. It doesn't have agility. It's fairly static. You know, once it doesn't move very easily, and therefore becomes the recipient of those things, not active. And so I think it's really a sort of paradox that in a house where it is the center of reflection, it is happening in an architecture which can't represent that in itself, but can only represent that through what happens. And I think this is central to this issue, but I think what's for me interesting about this is that history is important, and in other parts of the world we are forgetting that. We are forgetting all sorts of histories, and we are not reflective enough. And I think it is one of the positive characteristics of dealing with history. You know, it brings problematics, but I think it also
I would have to say that Germany has a much more sophisticated idea of reflection, which is not just a reflection about, you know, the war. It's a reflection about society. This tendency to reflect and to work through cultural, you know, debate is much stronger here than in other countries, especially the Anglo-Saxon world. So I think it's maybe it's uncomfortable to be in a building like this in some ways, but I think it also, as Okwui says, there's a certain justice in this.
Okay, one more question. Over. Okay. There's the gentleman over there. Okay, yeah. Okay, and then you, then we. Just make it, short.
Won't be all that short, but I'll try to make it short.
Okay.
I was very intrigued and amused by Mr. Chipperfield's comment on why can't we look at it as a pile of bricks, and I think I'm quite sympathetic with that. Maybe also being a foreigner, maybe we have an easier access to the history of this building. And I wanted to point out that there is another quite amusing change in society, changing buildings, and I don't know whether you're aware of that, and that is changing churches into profane buildings. It's a huge issue in the north part of Germany, and there is an amusing little detail about it. The Catholics thinks that a church is a sacred place and that the building is sacred, whereas the Protestants don't think that. And this in the transformation of churches that are needed, not needed anymore in this society, this is. And as we sort of engage or have to engage in downsizing buildings, if you might put it that way, from being sacred to another use, I think we can just as well engage in upsizing a building which has been maybe misused in many ways, but which actually transform into something very profitable for our society. Thank you.
Okay, this question here, then we can take both together. Excuse me, sir. Sir, over here. Just one more, sir, for conclusion.
I have a very short question. So I understood that you have more hope to improve the situation to the park, which is maybe not such a critical theme with the stationary traffic, like the parking slots, but the front. So how far will you go with your efforts to maybe fill in the tunnel to improve this situation? Maybe Minister Spaenle can say some words to that as well.
Well, of course, the tunnel doesn't help the visibility of the building. There's no doubt about that. But I think there's probably enough already to worry about with trees and parking before we worry about the tunnel. But I think all of these issues contribute to the sort of the poor positioning of the building in the city. And I think it's very difficult to imagine repositioning the building socially and intellectually in the city if you don't reposition it also physically. And I think that's the first task. I think a very quick answer to the first one, I mean, I understand this idea, in a way, can you cleanse this building somehow? Can you secularize it? And also, one would have to say there are other examples in history of buildings going from one use to another, and one belief system. If you think about the mezquitas in Spain being adopted by the Christian church, this is an extraordinary adaptation. Or Greek temples and Roman temples becoming the basis on which Italian churches were then built. So we have in the past, I mean, actually, it was very unusual to knock buildings down. You would actually add things to them more than knock them down. You would sort of reuse them. It's a sort of modern obsession that we, you know, we replace things instead of seeing them as layers of history, good and bad.
On that note, thank you so much, David, for your generosity and for...
You tricked me.
Well, you did say you did it 10 times in St. Louis, so we, you know, we have 9 more to go. Yeah, so follow the progress, so thank you.